The Lavelle telescope at Jodrell Bank is the dish that was used to track the Soviet lunar probes of 1959 through to 1976. Knowing that the Russians relied on this telescope to track their lunar probes, we contacted Jodrell Bank to ask whether or not this dish was used to track Apollo. Ian Morrison responded to our message. One did not need the Lavelle telescope to track the Apollo craft, as their signals were very strong. We used a 50-foot antenna to track all of them. However, this 50-foot dish only picked up frequencies of 2,300 MHz, not 2 GHz as the Apollo spacecraft had used.
Here, Ian Morrison confirms that Jodrell Bank used their 50-footer to track or follow Apollo 11 when it was near the moon, which incidentally left their Mark 1 free to simultaneously track Luna 15. And we've already shown that the downlinks from the Apollo spacecraft were transmitted in the 2300 MHz range, just as Ian remembered. Furthermore, the Soviets did not rely on Jodrell Bank to track their satellites. This false premise is the beginning of yet another strawman fallacy. During the Cold War, the Soviets had a reputation for being extremely secretive and deceitful, so any announcements of great achievements were often met with equally great skepticism by America and the rest of the world. Such was the fate of Luna 1. Many people did not believe, or did not want to believe, that Luna 1 actually existed, let alone that she made it to the moon. No one wanted to think that the Soviets had the capability to do that. So, for a short while, beginning with Luna 2, the Soviets began sending Jodrell Bank the pointing data to track their lunar probes that were destined to crash into the moon, so that Jodrell Bank could provide independent verification that the Soviets did have the technology they claimed to have. The Soviets did not require or depend on the services of Jodrell Bank. They used them as their overseas publicity department. It was nice to have Jodrell Bank around to prove to the world that they were telling the truth. That's all. The only time the Soviets actually asked Jodrell Bank for help was when they lost Venera 4 on its way to Venus.
Wikipedia and Encyclopedia Astronautica both state that in 1962, the USSR had constructed their own 52-foot antenna with a 100 million kilometer range. But what they fail to list are the frequencies that these stations used. According to Seven Gran of the Swedish space program, the downlinks for the old Soviet tracking stations used frequencies of 926 and 930 MHz. And the only gigahertz frequencies that they were capable of picking up were above 5 GHz.
Oh, this is a good one. First, Jarrah commits the fallacy of contradicting himself. Didn't he just tell us that the Soviets couldn't track their own spacecraft to the moon, and they were at the mercy of Jodrell Bank to track their lunar probes from 1959 through 1976? Now he tells us that in 1962, they built at least one 50-footer with a range of 100 million kilometers. That's more than 250 times farther than the moon. So if they had a radio telescope capable of communicating with space probes out beyond Mars, why didn't they use that radio telescope to communicate with their lunar probes that were only 385,000 kilometers away? It sounds to me that Jarrah just confirmed that from at least 1962 onward, the Soviets didn't need Jodrell Bank to track their lunar probes. Secondly, Soviet satellite communications has nothing to do with Apollo. It's a red herring. Why on earth would the Soviets invest a couple of billion rubles to build a network of radio antenna stations across Mother Russia and Cuba with ranges of 100 million kilometers that were only capable of sending or receiving radio signals on two frequencies, and use those stations only to communicate with their own satellites that are barely 200 miles overhead? Using Jarrah's logic, one could claim that during World War II, the Americans could not possibly have intercepted and decoded any Japanese radio transmissions because the U.S. Navy obviously didn't use the same frequencies as the Japanese to talk to their own ships. The fact is that satellite communication constraints are imposed at the satellite end only, Satellite radios are designed to be as light as possible and consume as little power as possible and still get the job done. The fact that each Soviet satellite was limited to only one pair of frequencies to communicate over, one up, one down, does not imply that the Soviet ground stations could not receive transmissions from space on any other frequencies. In fact, the ground stations had to be tunable, if for no other reason than to compensate for the unwanted but inevitable frequency drift of their satellite transmitters and the Doppler shift, the change in frequency caused by the satellite's motion toward or away from the ground station. Telescopes at deep space stations are primarily used to explore deep space and are equipped to examine the solar system over a wide spectrum of frequencies. Jodrell Bank, for example, is active 24/7 performing astrophysical experiments for a large number of customers. A typical dish reflects a wide variety of frequencies, and several different receivers can all work with the same dish. Jarrah shows the Soviet L-band and C-band frequencies from Sven Grand's website. These frequencies are on either side of the S-band used by Apollo. It would be ludicrous to assume that there would be a notch in the frequencies that the Soviets could receive corresponding exactly with the frequencies where the Apollo spacecraft transmitted. As with Jarrah's statement about the ham operators not being able to receive on frequencies they didn't transmit on, this is again a Texas sharpshooter fallacy. So, at the end of the day, contrary to Jarrah's claims, we find that nothing prevented either Jodrell Bank or the Soviets from picking up Apollo's signals. Neither Jodrell Bank nor the Soviets were on NASA's payrolls. Therefore, they both provided ample second-source verification that Apollo's radio communications were indeed coming from the moon. Ciao, moon hoax conspirators, wherever you are.